McKendrick Avenue. And then to take it higher,
rock it in the daytime.
Electric Avenue.
Rock it in the night.
This is the story of two unemployed musicians who built a hugely successful high-tech product in their London squat. Yes. Well, that's when you discover that it's not quite as easy as it looks. You suddenly find you've got too many arms and legs and none of them quite work in coordination. And even this takes about a year to get right. Yes, drumming takes a lot of dedication, a lot of money, a lot of time and some understanding neighbours. At least it used to. These days there's an alternative. Our two musicians came up with a home computer accessory using cleverly written software stored on cassette tape and a simple add-on box. This contains just a few readily available chips, including a digital-to-analog converter, which turns numbers in the software into sounds you can hear. Plugged into your home micro, anyone can sound like an expert drummer. It works like this. First, real sounds must be sampled. The continuous sound waves are divided up into steps. The height of each step is measured and stored as a number in the computer's memory. Then, by pulling the appropriate numbers from its memory and converting them back into sounds, the computer can play any desired drum rhythm. In 1984, drum machines cost a lot of money, so the market was there for a cheap one. Alan and Peter stumbled across this crucial gap in the market.
We were both struggling musicians, nearly starving musicians, and we'd both been on the dole for about 5 years, and we'd been living in the same house, and we're both keyboard players. What we both lacked was a drum machine, or any drummers to play with, basically. And so we sat down and designed ourselves a drum machine.
Why didn't you just go out and buy one?
We couldn't afford it, simple as that.
Now, you made it sound very simple, but how long did it take?
Well, first of all, we spent 3 months designing the basic machine, which allowed us to record and play back. And then we spent 6 months designing the program, which allows people to use it. And then 3 months finding somebody interested enough to make it.
How do you go about finding somebody interested?
Good question. We thought that would be the simplest, but we had a brilliant product. We thought everybody would be clamoring for it, but it wasn't quite like that. We spent a lot of time even getting anybody to listen to it, partly because it was written for the Spectrum, which wasn't then considered to be a musical computer. And partly because people seem very apathetic. They don't want to take on anything innovative. It's very strange attitudes.
So how did you end up with Cheetah?
They immediately showed an interest, said this is great. In fact, they were one of the first people to actually listen to the thing. And so obviously they were knocked out because it sounds so good.
One day I was sitting in the office and the phone rang. And these two guys said, look, we've got a fantastic idea for a drum machine which we'll plug onto the Spectrum. How about marketing it for us? So he said, yes, pop along. And about half an hour later, these two guys got over their three-wheeler with a huge speaker and this little box full of leads all over the place and plugged it in. It was absolutely superb and turned out to be one of the best peripherals ever sold in the home computer market.
You describe yourself as musicians. How did you get the know-how to invent a gizmo like that?
Well, I ordered a ZX81 from Clive Sinclair's company back in 1982 and built the kit and learned about computers from that.
It's a long way to actually inventing something, though, isn't it?
Yeah, it's been a long struggle.
We were messing about with some
D2A converters one night and realised that we could design our own drum machine using a computer. So that's how it came about.
But how do you design a drum machine? How'd you go about it?
Well, it started off with a lot of bits of paper strewn about all over the floor, and developed, this was the first prototype, which was just done on a little board and plugged into the back of a computer. And once that was done, it was just a question of designing the software to go with it.
That looks very simple for a drum machine. I take it that all the hard work is being done by the computer, is it?
That's right, yeah.
How did you go about programming that? What do you need to know?
You need to know a lot about the theory of sound and music, and a lot about machine code programming on a computer.
Did you know that already?
Yes, luckily.
So what's your role in this, Howard?
I'm just the poor old guy in the middle who has to try and get all the bits together and the engineers together and get them to design the right things and try and get out and sell it. The marketing side is very difficult. You can come up with the best product in the world, but unless it's marketed properly, unless it is what people really want, you can't sell it. And it has to be something that you can sell at the right price. And in our case, we're only interested in volume products, stuff that we can sell to a wide range of people.
How many did you sell?
We sold around about 30,000, I think, in the first year.
Sales of over 30,000 made the Spec Drum one of the biggest selling home computer accessories ever. After this amazing success, Alan and Peter set out on their next project. They wanted to make a self-contained drum machine which didn't need to be plugged onto the back of a computer. This meant they had to design a drum computer from scratch, building it up from chips bought from the local electronics shops and wiring it together to make a working prototype. Once they'd finished the development, they went to a recording studio to record or sample the drum sounds they needed. They had to assemble a collection of high-quality drum sounds, turning the continuous sound waves into streams of numbers which could be stored on computer tape. It took time to get right, but once happy with the sounds they'd stored on tape, they took them home to try out on their new machine.
Now, you guys have got a tremendous experience that most of us would never have. Supposing somebody out there has got this brilliant idea and he thinks it's going to be a world bestseller, what advice would you give him?
First of all, protect anything that you feel needs protecting, anything that you feel it's your own original idea that you might have copyright on. Well, you have copyright automatically on anything you do anyway, as long as it's original.
But you have to establish it.
You have to establish it. That's the important thing.
How do you establish that? Solicitors?
Well, it depends. If you have the money, yes, sure, go to an expensive solicitor in the city. But the cheapest way to do it is to put your listing in a registers envelope, post it to yourself, make sure that cashier stamps across the seal on the envelope so you know it hasn't been opened and you've got the date on it. Send one or two to yourself and then you have proof. If it comes to it, you can prove that this was written at that particular date.
Where do you get good advice?
That's what we want. It's very hard. When we did the Spec Drum, we thought that marketing it, getting somebody to do it would be easy, but we didn't even know what to expect in a business sense. I mean, we'd just come off the dole. We hadn't worked for a long time. We'd not had any experience with negotiating contracts or anything like that. We didn't even know what kind of royalty to expect. And there's no one to go and find out from. Mm-hmm. Although the government says they're going to encourage inventors and entrepreneurs, but there we were, we're trying to get ourselves off the dole queue, and yet there was no help available. We went to various government agencies like the Small Firms Advisory Service, but everybody told us completely different things. So luckily in the end we found someone that could help us, but it was touch and go.
Who was that someone?
We went to a trademark agent who then put us in touch with a good lawyer, who then put us in touch with a good patent agent, and we've been with those ever since.
Sounds as though it could be expensive.
It is expensive, yeah.
Alan and Peter are confident that using this home hobbyist technology, they can compete with the large Japanese companies.
Oh, sure. I mean, they can afford to spend 2 years and £2 million developing special chips to do things.
But then they have to return that price back to the user at the end of the chain.
Mm.
There's no way that they can produce a machine that compete with ours using their special chips, because they have to recover their development costs.
Plus, they're relying on hardware to do the job for them, and hardware's expensive. If you spend a lot of time writing good software, you can get around that problem. Software doesn't cost anything in terms of mass production.
Software might cost them nothing, but in most companies, skilled programmers earn high salaries. And when it comes to hardware, large manufacturers have mass production on their side. It is expensive to design special chips and set up advanced manufacturing systems. But once products are pouring off the production lines in huge numbers, the cost of each unit falls dramatically. Small companies find it almost impossible to compete directly with this kind of operation. They need to find niche markets, where the volumes of sales are too small to interest the mass producers. In the past, Cheetah has been successful at locating these niche markets.
There are lots of very good engineers around who have wonderful products, but you never see them, especially in this country. I would say to guys of this sort, don't go to the very big companies because you'll get lost. The product will take years to evolve. It's better to go to a medium-sized or a small company, a good marketing company, who can offer good advice and get the product to the market a lot quicker.
This is Howard Jacobson's big day, the day he hopes to see the first of the new drum machines produced. At the very factory in Cambridge where Acorn and Sinclair computer products first took shape. Many small companies put work out to board stuffing operations like this. This avoids them having to invest the large sums required to set up and manufacture themselves.
Of course, this is literally the day when it all comes together, isn't it? Or not?
We hope it all comes together. In theory, everything works. We get parts from all over the country, all over the world, in fact. These are made in Wales. These are made in Harborough. Printed circuit boards are also made in Wales. Hopefully, everything comes together. The rubber mat fits inside the moulding, which it does very nicely.
Right, yes.
We've had one or two slight problems.
What sort of thing?
The usual assembly problems that occur in first production runs. Like this printed circuit board here, which is the controls the keyboard, we have to drill the holes out because the holes are too small. So that's a minor problem that we have to do here. And also, let's hope these are the most awful problems that we're going to encounter during the assembly of this. Is this little part here fits into the printed circuit board, and of course the holes are slightly too small, so we have to modify these components. Which again is a job that we can do quite easily, thank goodness.
You don't look too downhearted about it though. Does this happen all the time?
This happens all the time with the best products in the world, and hopefully this will be one of them. And it's the problems that you have to overcome, and fortunately the people here are very good at solving these problems quickly.
Peter and Alan were at the factory to make crucial final checks on the drum sounds before they were loaded up into the production machines. Of course, at the moment, that's a long way off. We're still waiting for components and things. So how are you feeling at the moment?
We're just waiting for the box to arrive, yeah.
That's right, we're waiting to run off with one and take it home to play ourselves.
Ah, that's why you're really here, isn't
that's
it?
That's it, yes.
We haven't got a huge team of engineers. The product, this particular product, is really basically done with two engineers who work day and night. Okay, it's not 9 to 5. They have incentives, so the quicker they can get the product out, the better the product is, the more we can sell, the more money they earn.
I hear you've been burning the midnight oil a bit on this.
Yeah, slightly. Can't remember what our bed looks like.
When did you last go to bed?
Tuesday last week, I think.
No, it was the week before.
How are you feeling at the moment?
Very nervous because it's not coming together at the moment. There's a lot of work done, but a few people let us down with components, so there are a few guys off in their cars hunting around for a few chips at the moment.
Standard off-the-shelf stuff, is it?
Standard off-the-shelf stuff, we hope. The worst thing that could happen today is that we can't get these components and we can't produce the first machines, and therefore we can't test them, we can't see if everything goes together, and I go and jump off a bridge somewhere.
Good luck.
And as the board moves into the solder bath, there's still one chip missing.
It's been a problem from start to finish, from the first resistor to the metalwork, to the plastic mouldings, to the rubber keyboard. The whole thing's a problem because what we're trying to do is really put a quart into a pint pot, and we're producing a very, very sophisticated piece of equipment at very, very low cost. It's something that's never been done before. There are ideas associated with it and patented that nobody's thought of and nobody has thought possible before, and we've managed to do it and put it into a very small box at very low cost.
Now, when you take the lid off this drum machine, what you find is a lot of standard off-the-shelf components, not terribly expensive ones. So what are people really paying for?
They're paying for a lot of expertise. They're paying for absolutely brilliant software. A lot of the circuit is patented, so there's some very, very good ideas that have got in there. People are paying for the expertise, for the knowledge involved in producing a project, which is very, very complex. It's not just a matter of throwing a load of chips and resistors and capacitors onto a printed circuit board and hoping they come up with the right thing. Everything, it's a very, very complicated process, right from the layout of the exact boards, right through to getting the software right, to making sure that the sound quality is very good. And the software is extremely important. What people are paying for is excellent software, probably from two of the best software writers in the country.
Right, Howard, here we are. It's the end of the day and we've finally got one in a case. What do you think?
I think we've had a good day. A few minor teething problems, but we're there. I think we've got another good product.
It's still not quite working, though, is it? What's wrong here?
We've got a resistance problem, I think, with the key mat and sticking just a little bit. But we know how to cure that, and I think it's going to be maybe another couple of hard hours at it, and we'll be there.
And by the end of the night, a finished product.
First thing will be some busy hi-hats, like...
Okay.
And some toms. Leave the snare out for a while.
All right, take it back to the top.
Toms. See you, right.
Easy, Red.
Yep. Off you go.
Some months later, a restyled machine made its first appearance at the British Music Fair. Who is showing interest in it?
A few small recording studios and a lot of the people in the high street who want to make music at home with their home studios.
How'd you find it?
Yeah, it's an excellent machine, yeah. Works very well.
Would you buy one?
At this price, I'd be very interested, yeah, for home recording, which is what I'm interested in myself, yeah.
Then why not do it at home for a 20th of the price?
Yeah,
a studio that you can get in a mini, what's wrong with that?
The fact that you can load in different sounds means that you won't get bored with the sounds that, that you've got internally. That's great. Price-wise, there's nothing to beat it.
I think it's, for what it is, the amount of money that you pay for it, yeah, I agree with it.
They want to know why it doesn't cost £500.
For my own personal use, I wouldn't actually use one, but for teaching I would, because I could buy four of these for the price of one.
That's right.
High-tech Japanese thing, and it's made in England, etc.
That's
so
right. You're getting there, definitely.
Great.
I hope we're going to outnip the nips in the near future.
But with the new drum machine, they've moved out of the small niche market of home computer add-ons into the cutthroat world of international consumer electronics. Legal and production problems delayed getting the product to the shops in large numbers, by which time the multinationals had cut their prices. For Alan and Peter, the future is uncertain. Their foray into the mass market has not been as successful as they'd hoped, but the machine is proving popular with many musicians, and sales are finally picking up.